Cube at Big Data SV 2014 is brought to you by headline sponsors WAN Disco. We make Hadoop invincible and Actian, accelerating Big Data 2.0.
Okay, welcome back, everyone. We're here live at Big Data SV. I'm John Furrier, the founder of SiliconANGLE. It's our day one wrap-up of Big Data SV, covering the Strata Conference and all the happenings of Big Data in Silicon Valley, all the innovations. I'm here with my co-host, Dave Vellante, the co-founder of Wikibon.org, joined by industry analyst, Wikibon analyst, Jeff Kelly. Just put out the seminal report again on another authoritative Big Data study. Guys, this is the wrap-up. And day one, I think the initial vibe here in the report is ton of news. You see in the distros really being successful. Obviously, Hortonworks has the Red Hat announcement. They were just on early with Microsoft. You're seeing Big Data explode into more of a budget-oriented discussion. We're starting to hear now, we always say, where's the proof in the pudding? Where's the rubber meeting the road? Where's the steak on the meat on the bone? And that is customers. You're seeing a lot more business conversations with budgets, with deliverables, with outcomes. So very exciting. We had a lot of great people on, Dave. And what's your take? I mean, we'll get your take on today, and then we can go into some of the commentary.
Well, John, it's like I said earlier, I think you're seeing a lot of focus on partnerships, a lot of distribution, a lot of relationships, a lot of ecosystem development, which is a sign of maturity. I think we are hitting that phase of okay, we've heard a lot of announcements and product and other innovations, and now you're seeing more partnerships, you're seeing new pricing models, you're seeing people tweak, and I think, you know, toward the end of this year, you're going to start to see the pretenders separated from the contenders.
Jeff, what's your take on that?
I don't know if it's going to happen this year. I think it's going to take a little bit more time before the pretenders kind of get weeded out of the field.
Yeah, because there's still a lot of VC money.
There's a lot of money out there, so I don't think that's this year's going to happen. We'll see a couple. We saw a couple last year. We'll see a couple this year. But I think it's going to be a couple more years before we start to really see, you know, in our industry report, we had, 70 plus vendors. Maybe, I think next year we'll have just as many. But maybe in 3 years, it might only be, might be half that. So we'll see. But it will shake out.
So when's the
eventually.
Bubble burst? You're saying 2 years?
I think at least a couple years. I think at least a couple more years before you'll start to see the field winnowed through acquisition and through a few, some will fold.
So I got to get the take, Dave. We always talk about like the entrepreneurial sidebar conversation, startups making the innovation. Now this is Silicon Valley. What's your take, and from your standpoint, the state of the startup landscape for big data?
So I think, as we were just talking, there's still a lot of VC money in the pipeline. You're seeing, even though they wouldn't call it a roll-up, it's really interesting to see what Actian did in terms of bringing in all these different companies and presenting it as a platform. And at the same time, you look at a company like Brixada. Brixada is, solving problems that people have been talking about, and, we'll see. I haven't seen the solution yet, but from what they're describing and the customer uptake they're describing, there's still some innovation going on here. We saw that with Clear Story last year, sucking in a bunch of money. So I think there's still a way to go. I think that a lot of the things, whether it's text analytics, whether it's making Hadoop run better, whether it's real-time performance, a lot of those problems still haven't been solved. And I think there's money pouring in to a lot of startups saying, okay, go ahead and solve these problems. So when I was saying, toward the end of this year, you're going to start to, separate the pretenders from the contenders. I think this is the year that if you're very well funded with VC money and you've been around for a few years, 4 or 5 years, you better start to show customer traction, or you're going to be out of money in a couple of years, and you're going to be one of the ones that disappears. So I think that you're starting to see, it's like the jockeying before the start of the race. You're starting to see the positioning taking place, and I think you're starting to see some of the companies that are better positioned. I mean, I think that the big distro vendors are, all sort of, grabbing their spot, and their elbows are sharpened, and we'll see where it ends up this year.
I think this year is going to be, this is going to get intense this year. This is going to be a real fight, because you're starting to see real revenue from Hortonworks, from Cloudera, from MapR as well. MapR is not going away, by the way.
We never thought they were.
No, but some have questioned their kind of longevity, but I think they're around.
Silicon Valley whispers,
You hear it all the time. Yeah. But I think you're going to see this year is really when you've got companies like Cloudera, for instance. They need to hit the 100 million revenue mark because they want to go public the following year. You're going to see Hortonworks. Similarly, I think they have now kind of revved up their channel. They've got Teradata, they've got Microsoft, Salesforce ready to go out there and really start selling. I think you're going to see a real boost from them this year. And it's going to get, you know, if I think, you know, there's some back and forth in the market between those players and MapR as well. I think it's going to only increase this year. The stakes are high. There's a lot of money being invested. There might be more money invested in those companies this year. We might see more raised. So it's going to be really interesting.
So, John, when we first started here, it was like, okay, what is Hadoop and how can I use Hadoop? And Cloudera had no competitors. You were early on, you know, used to be co-resident at Cloudera offices. So you had sort of the early, you know, line of sight into this, the market trends. How has it evolved in your view, and what has surprised you, and what has not surprised you?
Good day, great question. I mean, if I think about it, it's a lot of things have surprised me. Some things haven't surprised me. One thing that hasn't surprised me is the dominance of Hadoop as a viable open source platform. I saw that early on. We both were early on in the Hadoop world. It's now evolved into an industry. It was pretty obvious that the trajectory was relevant, and it would be an industry. The disruption didn't surprise me. I think the disruption of Hadoop was as expected on my radar. What surprised me is Cloudera didn't dominate as much as I had thought they would. I thought Cloudera was going to absolutely be public by now. I thought that they would be dominating at many levels. I think that they got caught early on thinking that they had a good lead. I'm surprised by Hortonworks. I'm surprised by their rapid ascension to a number two, if not, you know, challenging Cloudera for a number one position. The Red Hat announcement and Microsoft clearly is validation for Hortonworks. But at the same time, Cloudera is validated. So what didn't surprise me was, I said when Hortonworks came into the market, I said there's plenty of beach for everybody. Remember that comment? There's plenty of beachhead, you know, just get your sections. That's true. I think the Cloudera-Hortonworks conversation never really materialized. I mean, I think GigaOm was like, oh, the war, the distributions. I don't think that there's going to be a problem. I think Hortonworks is going to have a good business model. I think Cloudera is going to have a great business model. I'm bullish on Cloudera. I'm surprised they didn't dominate as high they did, but I'm very bullish that Cloudera is going to have a nice position in the market. I think they're smart enough to differentiate, but clearly they're different vectors. You look at Hortonworks and Cloudera, completely different animals, in my opinion. Again, that was a surprise. I'm surprised that the big guys have not come in and done a lot of buying. That's a surprise. I thought there'd be a lot more M&A activity at this level. So I think this might be the year we see some of that M&A.
Yeah, do you think that the big guys just don't know what to buy yet? They don't know where to place their bets, or they don't think it's real? What's your take on that?
I think it's similar to enterprises out there. They're trying to determine who they're going to place their bets on, who they're going to bring in, whether it's the Hadoop distribution, which one to pick, if it's a NoSQL database, which one to go with. Similarly, the big guys, the mega IT vendors, they're not sure either. They're watching this play out just like the rest of us. And frankly, I think some of the big mega vendors really just are still just trying to get their thoughts together on how they're going to compete in this market, because it's so disruptive to the traditional business model of some of these big companies.
I think the reason why, in my opinion, is that it's just too frothy. I mean, if you look at the valuations of Cloudera, Hortonworks, it's just priced out. I mean, I think the VCs that are behind, say, Cloudera and Hortonworks are big-time VCs. You've got Excel in their contingent. Hortonworks has Benchmark in their contingent. They got big bets, right? They're expecting massive, you know, returns on that. So I think once you hit that valuation, you're way out of range. Look at on the consumer side, Box.net's going to go public. You got Dropbox. I mean, this is the valuations are outrageous. So if they don't get sold or go public before the bubble bursts, then it's going to come down to revenue. So that's why you're seeing this year really start to feel the energy that there's going to be an explosion of growth, because it's at that point now where if they don't start banking some revenue, there's a diminishing return going to kick in. So they have high valuations, and it's like, come on, we've been hearing this. Let's see it. So I think that's where the energy's coming from.
Yeah. So how important is the distro? You got the big three in the distro space. You know, we talk about IBM, we talk about Intel, others. But the big three, Cloudera, Hortonworks, and MapR. Mm-hmm. How important is it to sort of own the distro, and what impact has Hortonworks' entrance into the marketplace and their, you know, dogma toward open source affected that dynamic?
Well, I think Hortonworks has really changed the dynamic significantly. I mean, they're giving away the product. So, you know, that's significant downward pressure, price pressure on the other competitors in this space. And there's different ways to compete with that. You can try to build application, build kind of modules on top and kind of expand your value to those types of things like Cloudera is doing with Impala and their Spark announcement today. You know, MapR has been focusing more on the bringing in some transactional workloads on top of HBase, so they're kind of up leveling the conversation is one way to compete with that. You know, how important is it to own the distro in the sense that, you know, owning the market? I mean, it's a potentially valuable market, but it's not huge. You know, actually, when you look at our forecast, Hadoop is really just a small slice of the overall big data market, and we, you know, forecast it to remain that way.
So you're saying it's not critical?
Well, I mean, I think it's...
From a leverage standpoint.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's an important part of the overall picture, but it's not the most important thing necessarily. And there's so many other components that go into leveraging data, big data, and that's, you know, we've talked to SyncSort today around data integration. You know, one topic we didn't get into too much today is the cloud and what role that's going to play. And then you've got, there's all the applications providers that are going to come out of the woodwork as we kind of progress, as the infrastructure hardens. And that's where the real value is, in my opinion, is the applications and the service providers.
I want to ask you about the changes in pricing models. So my understanding is Cloudera has changed its pricing model or is sort of still experimenting. What do you know about that? What can you tell us about that?
So they've simplified their pricing model. You know, I think they got some customer feedback that essentially their old model was confusing, and they, you know, made the strategic decision to streamline their offerings and how they price those. So essentially now they've got three basic pricing levels. They've kind of got the basic edition, which is your core Hadoop and then the management software, including their proprietary management software. They've got what they're calling Flex, their Flex option, essentially. In addition to the core Hadoop and the management software, they, you know, one of the add-on modules, whether it's Impala or Spark or Search, and then their Enterprise Data Hub is the third pricing level, which is essentially all you can eat. It's the core Hadoop, it's the management software, and as many of those modules on top as you want to use. So, you know, they've just tried to make it a little bit simpler. Before, they had subscriptions for backup and recovery, for
too much granularity.
Hadoop. Yeah, it was just a bit confusing, and they realized it was important to just kind of simplify that. And, you know, from a pricing perspective, they're pricing that both on, you can price that as a per terabyte or per node. So, you know, they're trying to offer a little bit more flexibility, but at the same time, simplify it. So, you know, that makes sense. I think it's a smart move. Frankly, there's a lot of confusion still in this market, whether it's Hadoop specifically or big data generally. So, you know, when you can take steps to simplify the conversation and make things a little bit easier for the customer to understand, that's a good thing.
We're still seeing, Dave, the trends. I've been taking notes here, the themes, data science, the Hadoop market still rocking, database applications and development, legacy vendors, and then new emerging areas, new modern approaches. You know, I think the big developer conversations is also going to continue to accelerate. We're seeing that here today. The SQL, that genie's out of the bottle. That's going to be a done deal. I think the big gorilla guys are going to take that down. I just, you know, if you're a startup, you better have a nice niche in that market or big muscle.
Yeah, well, I mean, SQL on Hadoop is an important part of the overall Hadoop as a fully functioning multi-application platform, but that's what it is. It's a feature. So, you know, it's one part, but it's a challenge to build a business just on that alone.
So, Jeff, you were out there on the ground at Strata Conference. We were broadcasting live here at Big Data SV right across the street. What was it like out there? What was the vibe? Just give us some highlights. Who did you see? Did you see any celebrities? Any action at all? We had a lot of celebrities here on theCUBE. Obviously,
You probably had more celebrities here today. So it's day one over there at Strata, so a lot of the full day and half day workshops. So, you know, not a lot of the
core audience.
Yeah, the exhibition floor wasn't even open yet. So not a lot of action to see. You know, I did hear a little bit, talked to a couple of the folks that attended the data science track today, and there was a little disillusionment with that. You know, a lot of the data scientists were people that attended the data science track, whether they call themselves data scientists or not, were a little disappointed that the content didn't go a little bit deeper, frankly, and they were talking about that on Twitter. So that's, you know, that's a challenge, I think, for somebody like O'Reilly over Strata. They put together this great conference. But I think when it started, it was really, you know, it was, as we've talked about today, as you guys have talked about today in theCUBE, it was a lot of, mostly T-shirts. So it was data scientists and hackers and doing some really cool, in-depth, hands-on stuff. And then, you know, now we've got a lot more business people there. And so as the core audience of a show like Strata expands, you know, that's the challenge, is to keep it relevant for all those different stakeholders. So
a lot of skill gaps, a lot of educational coming down, a lot of Hadoop, data science, big data, data transformation, data fusion. You know, Dave, I always talk about our first Hadoop where Abhi Mehta and yourself and I were talking about, you know, data factories, the revolution. You know, Abhi Mehta, if you're out there watching, you know, shout out to Treseda, a great friend. He first coined the term data factories in New York City when it was Hadoop world. And we're seeing that. You're seeing the data fusion. You're starting to see playing and partying with data in a way that's business line, C-level, not CIO. This comes down to the data manager. Who's going to be doing the data? So these data factories need to be managed by people who know how to manage data.
You know, there hasn't been much discussion today about security and data privacy, and I would expect the balance of this week we're going to hear more about that. We mentioned Abhi. We're going to have Abhi Mehta on later this week. I don't know if the guys from Squirrel coming on. I think they are. So I'm sure they'll be talking about security as well and privacy. But, you know, with cloud and Snowden and all of that stuff, it was a big topic of discussion last year. Certainly, it really, I think, peaked at Hadoop Summit and then carried through Big Data NYC. What have you been hearing about the whole security meme?
Well, I think, without question, security is critical, and it's not getting enough coverage or enough. People are not putting enough thought into it right now, and I think it's going to be a challenge as we kind of go from this really early adopter to early mainstream adoption of Hadoop and some of the other surrounding technologies. Security and privacy are two issues that are going to continue to come up, and the industry really needs to address it. You know, with the NSA scandal, most of the, you know, the ire of the public has been mostly focused on the government. But I think as people start to realize just how much data commercial enterprises are collecting and using, it's going to turn pretty quickly to the commercial side. So I think the industry, and I've been saying this for a couple of years now, needs to get out in front of this topic.
John, what do you got?
So I just want to do a shout out, and just as we wrap up this segment, thank our sponsors. So, you know, we would not be here if it wasn't for the support of the community. We've been doing big data coverage now. We're on our fifth season. Dave and I have interviewed, and the CUBE team, over 3,204 guests, I was told by our team. Actually, was like telling me, well, we've interviewed over 1,000 people. Damn, 3,200 plus people, Dave. That's ridiculous. I'm just kidding. Who are their names? No.
Pat Gelsinger.
But we would not be able to do this without the support of sponsors. We have an underwriting model to maintain that independent action, bring that tech sports coverage to you. We love it. We love doing it. And the sponsors here for Big Data SVR, WANdisco, Actian, HP, Vertica, Cloudera, Treseda, MapR, SyncSort, InfoObjects, Alteryx, and Squirrel. We really appreciate it. You know, and shout out to WANdisco. They were also a sponsor in Big Data NYC. You know, it's the support of the community and giving the vote of confidence with the sponsorship. We really appreciate it, and allows us to do our thing and pay the freight to get all the equipment and the team here, the full team's here. And we're doing crowd chats. We're doing our best to extract the signal and share that openly and publicly. So thank you very much.
I also want to say, so we're here broadcasting at the Hilton. We're in this Yosemite room today, tomorrow, Wednesday, and all day Thursday. Also, tomorrow night, Wednesday, at 6 o'clock, we've got a reception, a party going on in the coastal room. Just come into the Hilton, go to the right. You'll see us there. So all our friends in Silicon Valley, even if you're not at Strata, if you are at Strata, definitely stop by. But even if you're not at Strata, come on by. We're in Santa Clara, right in the heart of the valley. So you're more than welcome. Friends of theCUBE, love to see you guys.
Great. We're going to be back all day live tomorrow. Packed house, sold out. Everything's sold out. All the slots are filled. Editorial guests will be reporting live. Ton of news to talk about. A lot of action. Now it's time to go hit the Matt Bar party. We're right next door. We happen to have a beer with those guys. So it's beer time for the Cube guys. I'm John Furrier with Dave Vellante and Jeff Kelly and the whole crew. We'll see you tomorrow live, first thing in the morning, here on Big Data SV, hashtag Big Data SV, live from Silicon Valley, Big Data Silicon Valley. We'll see you tomorrow.